that's one cause of not dreaming much, is where there's not much psychological conflict or lower chakra blockage. But I completely agree with you. There are other people who do not dream much, meaning they don't remember dreams much, because they're very well defended and very blocked from conscious self-awareness. So there are multiple causes for not dreaming much or not remembering dreams. Yes. Right. See, this is a importance of very careful sentence formulation. There are multiple causes to any single effect or consequence. As in the case or the effect or consequence or phenomena of not dreaming much, that can be called not remembering dreams much. It can be the result of a soul who's significantly cleared the lower triad and doesn't have much psychological conflict at all. Therefore, they don't the deep mind doesn't produce much dreams, much dreaming. And then there can be the cause of not dreaming much or not remembering dreams much because the person is very highly blocked consciously. And then also there can be the condition of not dreaming much or not remembering dreams much because the person is so physically tired that the subconscious dream production has been suspended for deeper functions of physiological healing or survival that would not be as well done if the person keeps dreaming. So the subconscious, the person still has blockages, or lots of blockages, but the body is so tired, or the mind is so tired from various causes, that the subconscious is not producing a lot of dreams. People who work 14 hours a day. So we have to be very subtle here if we want to understand life. Right. So first of all, quote, having a dream, or quote, dreaming a lot, is distinct from, quote, remembering dreams well. So there are people who can't remember well and will say and may imagine they're not dreaming much. Now, is it that they're not remembering their dreams or they're not dreaming much? Well, they're not the same. So there are people who know that they've had it. It's like we wake up in the morning. We know we had a dream, but we don't remember it. Okay? That's dreaming without remembering. It's possible that there can be a lot of dreaming with a lot of not remembering. Then there can be not dreaming a lot. Therefore, there's nothing to remember. That not dreaming a lot, which is not the same as not remembering, although it may be, may not be, that not dreaming a lot can come from physical exhaustion, physical devitalization, and the prioritization, the subconscious mind prioritizing physical healing over the production of dreaming. Then there can be the non-production of dreaming because the person is so well defended subconsciously that the subconscious is inhibited as well. Then there can be the production of dreaming, little or a lot, that is associated with the person who is so defended that they can't stop the dreaming, but they can stop the remembering. Then, in the case of non-production or non-remembering, there's the person who's significantly cleared in the lower triad, and the subconscious doesn't need to be producing much. So you see, there's a difference between dreaming, dream production, or dreaming, and remembrance of dreaming. And then in the case of dreaming, not much dreaming, or not much remembering dreaming, the case where there is a lot of dreaming, but there's not much remembering, and the case where there's just not a lot of dreaming. And the case of not much dreaming itself can be from both a significant clearance of the lower triad blockages, as well as being a highly defended so highly that the subconscious doesn't even produce dreaming. So you see, it's all complicated. That's also true. That's called a metaphysical dream, or the interpretation of a metaphysical experience as a psychological dream, which is a mistake. And so, yes, wanderers are more likely to have metaphysical experiences that come out as dreams that may be more or less remembered. That metaphysical experience of nighttime may be out of body. It may be higher self inspirational. It may be visions of past or future, and all sorts of other things. So, yes, some wanderers have more proficiency in dream recall. Some wanderers have more proficiency in meaning. That just means remembering. There are some people who remember dreams really well, but they don't interpret them very well. There are other people who can remember them quite well and interpret them quite well. There are some people who can't remember them quite well, but still can interpret them quite well. There are some people who have more discernment in that this really was a metaphysical experience, not a psychological dream or psychological product, but I can't interpret it well. So, maybe what you're really asking is, do some wanderers have more proficiency in using metaphysical experiences that are not psychological dreams but occur at night, interpreting them and using them for their own evolution? Of course, the answer is yes, some do. Then your real question in terms of what you don't know, not what you do know, ask questions about what you don't know, not what you do know. Find what you don't know, or find the zone of what you don't know, and then formulate the question directed there. What you're really asking is something about the proficiency of yourself as one wanderer in a certain ability to know or make use of metaphysical dream or metaphysical experience as dream. But it's not clear to me what particular aspect of that skill of recall or knowing metaphysical experience is the target of your real not knowing or your question. Psychological dream or metaphysical? Or both? Okay. So, some wanderers, indeed, with that skill of dream, psychological dream, metaphysical experience, interpretation, which is basically symbolic knowing. Why do some wanderers have that skill and some don't? Or why do some wanderers have that development and others don't? a person who's a great archer and can shoot an arrow really well, is their purpose in coming to Earth the development or utilization of that skill? Not necessarily. No. There are people who are great athletes who are missing some crucial aspects of their life purpose by the fact that they think that their life purpose is not much more than the utilization of their skill. Meaning, the existence of a skill is not the same as a life purpose. And there are many purposes in one's life that may be supported, the fulfillment of those purposes may be supported by the skills or abilities that the wanderer brings in. But the focusing on that skill or development isn't the purpose of their incarnation. And there may be purposes for the wanderer's incarnation that have nothing to do with their skills at all, but have to do with what they have not developed, not what they have developed. So a wanderer that's a great archer, hello, big butterfly, a wanderer who's a great archer or a great warrior, may think that the purpose of their life is to keep using that skill for some purpose. It may have nothing, the purpose of this incarnation may have nothing to do with that skill, but they assume it does. So don't assume it does. The point is to look into what's difficult And there you'll find potential growth. And the actualization of that potential, or making that growth in the face of whatever we find difficult, that's associated with life purpose or incarnational purpose. Not necessarily any skill or any further development of a skill or any utilization of a skill. That may or may not be associated with a life incarnational purpose. Yes. So one has, and we all do, have multiple purposes that have nothing to do with our abilities. They have to do with what we're not able to do well. So, like, I can say me, right? I'm a teacher. Oh, what a great skill. There are certain purposes to my incarnation now that have nothing to do with this, that I may neglect and avoid by focusing on my skill, or this that is easy, or not, you know, troublesome. So focusing on what I do well may actually be a great means of avoiding working through what I don't do well, which is much closer the development of mind or being associated with facing and taking on the responsibility of learning that which I don't do well, learning certain things or make certain development in ways I don't do well, may be far more important to life purpose than the elaboration or continuance of what I already do well. That's a very bitter pill. And actually, it's the case for all of us. So let me go on. I mean, the reality is that actually every single topic we may address is deep and complex. Everything is deep and complex. Everything. There is nothing simple if we wish to uncover multiple levels of meaning and significance and process-related dynamics like cause, effect, multiple influences, purpose, usage, misusage, all of the, you know, processual, meaning process-related dynamics of anything is profoundly complex, in fact, endlessly complex, if we wish to examine meaning and function in such detail. If we wish to know anything in its function and activity and relationships and significance, cause and effect, and progression and influence and multiple interconnections, everything is profoundly complex. And that's the basis of the statement that the spiritually mature may make, that the more I learn, the more I realize I know so little. Because the more one learns, the more one sees the endless levels of significance that can be determined. That we know that whose determination or which determination we've done very little of. And all that we see and all that we speak and all that we know is a tiny, tiny, tiny portion of all that can be spoken and known and determined for everything. And so that's exactly why the wise know they know so little, because they see how much can be known. Well, I mean, it depends on what purpose we're addressing. There's the purpose of a question, and the purpose of a question is to answer it, I guess. You know, I'm asking so I get an answer. But the question may be very general. Tell me about major dynamics of karma multi-incarnationally. So that's a pretty general question. Then the purpose of asking is to have an answer with a little more specificity in a general way about karma. Then there are specifically focused questions, and the purpose would be to answer that in ways that address the unique case and its specifics. So, in a way, the whole thing is about theory and practice. So, I mean, the value of the specific or very tightly focused questions You know, there's value to general and there's value to specific. The value to specific is, first of all, to see how the general case or theory manifests or plays out in the dynamics of personal life. And then to get some learning on how to handle situations better or whatever the focus is. Then we can also learn about the general or the theory more by analysis of the specific. So like Buddhism, Buddhist theory or Buddhist doctrine, particularly, let's say, the three marks or the three poisons, right? The three marks being anicca, anatta, dukkha, impermanence, insubstantiality, and stressfulness or suffering. tell me about the theory. Well, at some level, our understanding of theory will remain limited to the extent that we don't consider and know well how it plays out in the specific practice of daily life or incidents of a personal life experience. And so that's many ways associated with the insight of insight meditation or vipassana or awakening. The support for further awakening is the application of the theory to the personal, the theory to the practice. Like, as I experience the arising of thoughts and feelings in meditation or daily life, to what extent can I see their impermanence and insubstantiality and stressful nature? Like the stressful nature of pleasure or the impermanence of pain. So, what is the stressful nature? How can you say that pleasure is dukkha? How can you say that misery is impermanent? Well, you can say, how can you say it in the moment? Feeling pain or sorrow or grief, can you really know that it's impermanent as you're in it? Can you really know that, do you know that all the pleasures that we've worked hard for are impermanent and stressful in the moment too? I remember I said this example once where I was looking forward to lunch at the monastery, as many people do, at 11:30 in the Zendo, thinking, oh, I want to eat. Oh my God, I'd rather stop sitting here and go eat. And then after, you know, the sitting is over, and we walk to the dining room area, and then we're sitting down, and we pass the bowls, and we do our chanting, and then we start eating. After all that, for my, you know, beloved experience of eating, realizing the food had no taste. If I wasn't thinking about, oh, this is so great, oh my God, it tastes so good, if I wasn't thinking, or as the mind was not thinking, realizing it had no taste, and then I was really crestfallen and realized, oh, even this pleasure is dukkha, and it's not even, there's really nothing to be attached to when the mind is silent or without fashioning thoughts of associated with the taste and my happiness and dot, dot, dot. It actually has no taste. There's nothing even here. The insubstantiality, anatta, of taste, of sensation itself. And then, oh, not just this yummy meal will leave soon. That's easy. This yummy taste will end soon. This yummy taste ain't no yummy taste. There ain't no yummy taste. Oh, that's anatta. And that's dukkha. And then I really was really discouraged then. But that's life. So, well, I'm not fully enlightened, so I wouldn't know. I mean, I would assume they have no psychological dream. But, I mean, I ultimately could not answer that, because I'm not at that level. Well, even the phenomenon of yogic sleep, I personally feel is not well defined and is not clear. It seems to me that people who talk about that have their own understanding of what it means, which is not sort of unified with other people who use the same term. So I'm not sure. I mean, it's not clearly defined to me what it really is. Some people would say lucid dreaming is a kind of yogic sleep. Some people will say dreamless sleep is yogic. Some people would say samadhi is yogic sleep. Some people would say going out of body is a kind of yogic sleep. So there's a whole range of opinion about what it is. Meanwhile, most of those people are not adepts. So it's hard to say. You see? Because I'm not sure. When somebody says yogic sleep, it's not clear to me exactly what that means. Because it's been used in many ways for many types of experience. Okay, yeah. So here, we can say the source is good, meaning it's on Guttara Nikaya from the Pali Canon. The translator is good or great, Tanasaro Bhikkhu, so we can trust it. Immediately, we can go to the other translation from Piyadasi Thera, and just to compare and just get a sense of what's going on. One sleeps easily, wakes easily, dreams no evil dreams. Looking at the other translation, he sleeps in comfort, he awakes in comfort, he sees no evil dreams. Okay. So, comfortable sleep and waking, comfortable and easy. Sleeps easily, wakes easily, sleeps and wakes comfortably, comfort and ease in sleeping and waking. That is associated with no evil dreams. Seeing no evil dreams, dreaming no evil dreams are the same. And I think your question means, what does it mean? The question is, what does that mean? what's an evil dream, right? Well, I think in this case, evil means associated with harm. And that would be associated with violence. Or what? Death and destruction? But there are yogis who dream of future disasters. And it may be very important that certain adepts or yogis dream of future disasters to protect the community or people in some area. Does that contradict the sutra? Meaning, the sutra says dream no evil dream or seeing no evil dream, but this guy dreamt of a disaster. Well, is that an evil dream? Or is he a fake yogi or something? No, I don't think that's what evil dream means. I would say that it would be dreams associated with anger, aversion, and probably dreams associated with greed or desire or strong lust or longing. Yeah, I'm not sure either. But... You know, a dream, a precognitive dream of a future disaster that in fact really does happen, or in fact is prevented partially by what's done by the dreamer after that dream, meaning to change something or whatever. Was that an evil dream? I'd say no. What is evil? Right, that's really what we're looking at here. What is the evil? And then we'll know what's an evil dream. I would say it's certainly going to be associated with kleshas, you know, with strong distortion in mind or blockage. I'm not sure. Again, I'm not sure how, you know, what the Buddhist teaching here specifically refers to regarding what constitutes an evil dream. There are dreams of possible futures that are not precognitive in any way, but they're simply associated with strong fear. And so it's very hard to know whether a dream of a future disaster is wholly, wholly meaning completely psychological and has nothing to do with the future. It only represents, it only comes out of a strong, strong fear of a possible future. Or it really is a vision of a possible future, or a vision of the most likely or even definite future. I mean, there is the near-term future and the far-term future. And there is the there is a set of probable futures, and in terms of other future occurrences, there is no set because it's 99 to 1 or 100 to 0 that it'll be one future and there's nearly no other possibility. Like, everybody's going to die and leave their human body. Well, that's a likely future. Not likely, it's near definite, and we can say definite. So, having a future, a dream of my death in the future, it would be definite, from our limited understanding, that that person really will die. And so it's not a possible future, it's the future. It's the only one future regarding whether they stay in their body indefinitely or leave the body. No, they really will leave, they really will die. But as to how the specifics of the dream in terms of how they die or when they die, what's all going on, a lot of it may be psychological. And it may not be also, or it may be partly psychological and partly a mixture of multiple possible futures. Okay? So it's that complicated. But in terms of an evil dream, he sees, you have to see also in this sutta, which is the metta nisamsa, meaning metta, metta nisamsa sutta, and it's called Discourse on Advantages of Loving Kindness, or Goodwill. You know, metta is goodwill. To say that it's just goodwill, why didn't it call it metta sutta? Well, is it metta sutta or is it metta nisamsa sutta? Well, it's obviously not just metta, so it's not just goodwill. It's pretty much like advantages of metta, the discourse on advantages of metta. Now, that's associated with love or fourth chakra or loving kindness. Loving kindness, metta, obviously, is associated with love, green ray, on all the qualities of green ray. And so, dreams, no evil dreams, I think is in the context of the type of dream that doesn't happen as fourth chakra is very highly or well developed. So dreams, the type of dreams that come when heart chakra is significantly blocked, and the type of dreams that don't come when heart chakra is significantly activated, is where we'll find the answer to what evil dreams are. So there can be precognitive dreams that are true. There can be precognitive dreams that are just one possibility among many with heart chakra activation. And if it's a scary future or destruction, it's not an evil dream, because there can be a precognitive knowing or sensing dream of a possible or definite future that is destructive, that is not associated with any lower chakra blockage, but it's going to happen, you know? There are people in a disaster zone who didn't have heart chakra blockage. There are not many, but there are some. So, likewise, there are other people who, would call that an evil dream, but I don't think so. Well, the thing is, there are dreams that can be called evil dreams that exist because of very strong fear-level blockage. So, dreams of being pursued, dreams of being attacked, dreams of some kind of foreboding, destruction or crisis or trouble coming. All sorts of dreams that are associated with harm can come not by precognitive linkage or precognitive sensing, but simply by as the subconscious result of very strong fear. And so what could be felt, they're in my view, just briefly, an accurate, real precognitive dream of a definite or likely future associated with destruction can still happen with heart chakra activation. But there are certain levels of fear and anger, fear, desire, and anger, or certain type of dreams that come from strong fear, strong desire, strong anger. Certain types of dreams from those distortions or blockages that won't come when there's very strong heart chakra activation. That's, I think, what is meant by evil dreams here. So, anyway, thank you for the questions. Very good, as always. Please take good care of yourselves. See you next time, and good night.